Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
They said I could get up here this morning and cut up a little.
Oh, that is sad.
I know.
Good morning, Amy and George.
Good morning.
Now,
yes, Lord.
What a mighty God we serve. How many of you want to honor God today?
Well,
that's
Lord.
Four hands. That's a few.
Amen.
That's all we want to do this morning is honor God. We've got some people out today, some that are doing other things for the Lord this morning, and some that are not feeling real sporty. So remember to pray for those that you don't see and those that you do see. Pray for me especially. I need all the help I can get. Would y'all join us in prayer?
Yes, Lord.
Father, we just want to thank you today for this awesome opportunity to come together to worship you. God, regardless of the numbers, the hearts are here, Lord. Help us to honor you and to serve you with a pure heart, with a clean conscience, Father, as we stand before you, knowing that you are our God, that Jesus is our Redeemer, our Savior, and our soon coming King. That because of him, we can say that we are righteous. Father, we're in right standing with you, but only because of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Not because of anything we can say or do. God, help us to honor you today and to bless you in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Yes, Lord. Rejoice for the steps.
Praise you, Jesus. Psalms 37:23 says, rejoice for the steps of a righteous man. They are ordered of God.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. So let's stand and worship the Lord this morning.
Lord.
you're so good to us, Lord. Hallelujah. This song is actually for Doug and Christina. We're doing it for Christina. Doug's not here to hear. He had an emergency situation. And this was his last Sunday to worship with us before going out on his new education department.
Thank you.
psalm, so I'm waiting to get the cue to get up here and do something. What an amazing God we serve. Amy, it's so good to see you this morning. You know, as we get up here and we worship the Lord and we sing these songs, there's some of Christina. Do you have that one? There it is. As we were singing this song, and you think about the words, more than the air I breathe, I need you, God, yes, that word. More than the next song I sing.
Yes, Jesus.
Look at that third one. More than the next heartbeat. God, I need you more than that. Because I can live with you forever without the next heartbeat. But without you, that heartbeat is meaningless. More than anything. Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. Are you going to be there one day? Because I never want to go back to my whole life. My whole life has nothing. And you know, I used to have fun. And I know some others that did the same thing. And I thought it was fun. But I wouldn't go back to what I had for anything in the world. Because what I have today is forever. Yes. And it's all because of Him.
Yes.
You know, as we sing these songs, I put a substitute into the songs. Lord, as you touch Him, or Lord, as you touch me, and let us serve you. Don't let me serve you. When you sing these songs, I wish we could go through it and edit every one of them and put me, the first person, substitution. I'll be by your side. Put yourself in there as you're singing these songs. Look at them and think about, God, it's just me and you. It's not the whole group. And the whole group's included. But when I'm singing praises to Him, it's me and Him. I could care less about you at that moment. And please understand that. And you're just as important to God as I am. But at that moment, it's me and God. It's not y'all and God. Just me and God. What a remarkable God we serve. And He's got everything in control. So I can get up here and cut up a little bit and have fun and still honor Him and serve Him. Do you know that? Well, a couple of announcements, actually four announcements, I guess. First of all, don't forget Wednesday night. What do we got? Bible study in the fellowship hall Wednesday night. Saturday morning, men's breakfast. I don't know who's going to cook Saturday, but it'll be a surprise to all of us. Don't forget Miss Beth. Please pray for her. She's in the hospital battling infection. And is there any update on her, anybody?
I saw her on Friday and she looked great. I spent an hour with her talking with her, but I saw her on Friday, and she was doing good. I sat and talked with her. I had to calm her down to stop talking so much so I wouldn't get in trouble for boring her out or anything. But then Zena saw her last night and said she wasn't doing so well last night. Give us an update, sister.
They said that the doctor actually had come in while I was there, and before he had come in, she was complaining that she was in a lot of pain, and she said it was in her chest, and then She described it as a triangle in her back that was, she could hardly breathe. You could see her chest. Well, when the doctor did come in, he did an overlook over her and everything, and they were increasing her medication. She couldn't hardly talk. She couldn't eat because she couldn't talk. She couldn't talk because she couldn't do anything because she couldn't breathe. Mm-hmm. Well, they said that her lungs had fluid in them and that she had went septic. I don't know what that is, but her body had went septic. And they were going to start her on medication. She is not going to be leaving on Monday. She will be staying at Garden Park. And she is in a regular room right now if anybody wants to see her.
Please pray for her. Septic, if I understand, is infection throughout your entire system.
Yes, she's very weak.
She needs God's touch.
Yes.
Short of God, the doctors can't do anything. Please pray for her. We've got other people out this morning. Pray for them. You may not know who they are or their names, but just pray for the body of Christ as a whole. We got one other thing coming up. Oh, that's next Sunday. Mm-hmm. We have to go through that ordeal.
Oh, man.
Man.
It involves food.
So there's a list in the back, a sign-up sheet. We're having the 4th of July celebration on the 12th. So
amen.
We can't count numbers. Who cares? We're going to have a heat meeting.
Amen.
So check the sign-up list in the back. If you're not signed up, plan on bringing something. Even if you can't cook something, like me and Mr. Billy, come anyway. There'll be plenty of food back there. So come and join us in that. We're going to give you an opportunity now to honor God with his tithe and our offering. Can I get the two, almost the two oldest fellows in the room to help us out this morning? Oh, and don't forget, I walked off and forgot mine this morning. Somebody didn't forget our change. It helps with the food pantry to buy food for people, to feed people that have a need. I walked off and left mine a new habit, but I didn't bring it. Somebody was faithful to bring his. I don't know who he is.
Would you pray for this morning? Father God, we have so much to thank you for. Lord, we have little or nothing to complain about.
Yes,
Lord. But I'm convinced, Lord, that if you chose from this moment on to not bless us another single time, that we would have no complaints.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you that your promise is ongoing and never ceases.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
And so, Lord, as we give to you that which you gave to us,
yes, Lord,
we ask, Lord, that Lord, that it would be a blessing in the kingdom of God, Lord, that it would be a source of healing and redemption in us
as
we give out and give back to you.
Yes, Lord.
And we give you praise and honor in Jesus' holy name.
My Jesus.
Amen.
Holy are you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Holy are you, Lord.
Praise you, Jesus. Get with God's wonderful people.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. Are you one of God's wonderful people? I am. Are you Donnie?
Yes.
Amen.
Yes,
I love the thrill.
But they're sure. Trust and confide in their trust. Thank you, Father. If you think you can, I can. Thank you, Father, for this time to give your tithe and our offerings. You take them and use them, Father, as you will. We trust it in your hands.
Yes.
And we thank you, Father, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, let's get a little exercise and stand our feet and do this one again. If you're able, if you can. Just sit there and enjoy the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh,
God. Praise God Almighty. What a thing to come together. What an amazing thing it is that we get to come in fellowship together in the house of God and giving glory and honor and worship Him.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus, and that He welcomes us into His presence. Isn't that something? And that's what we're doing, about to do with the communion here. Communion means to come together and communicate with one another, to have an intimate relationship with one another, to be involved in one another's life, and that's what He came here to do. He came because He loved you that much, Rudy. He came because He said, oh, I got to go see Zena. I got to catch her. I got to get her. And here she is. Praise God. Tony, He came for you, brother. He came and gave up His blood and His body so that He might have fellowship with you. Isn't that amazing? He loves us that much. He wanted us that much. Oh, Lord Jesus, that He welcomed us. He said, yeah, I'll go and do it. I'll go and do it. I'll give my blood. I'll give my body. Let them beat me with stripes, many stripes, so I can heal them. So that I can heal them. He wanted to heal you, Amy. He wanted to heal you. And He's healing. Little by little, He's healing. Praise God Almighty. He comes and welcomes us into His presence. He gave everything so that we could come and be a part of His life, and He can be a part of ours, that we can intermingle with Him. Our Lord Jesus. The world's crazy, isn't it? The world's insane. It's gone. It's lost every bit of compass it ever had. There is no moral compass whatsoever in the world any longer. It's the people that are in it, yeah. But praise God, we get to come together in fellowship with Him. Fellowship with Him. Come and fellowship together, or we can come together in fellowship with Him. So as we come with the brothers and sisters, whoever we've got lined up for the communion, come on up, please. Man, what an honor it is to be able to come into the house of God Almighty. And He allows us to feel His presence. Yes, Lord Jesus. Father, we thank You so much that You chose us, Lord God. We didn't choose You. We thank You for Your body and Your blood that You gave so willingly, Lord God. Oh, Lord Jesus, let Your anointing rest upon these elements, Lord God, even as we take them, Lord Father, that You go and minister to us, Lord God, in a way that we've never had before. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you chose us from the beginning of time, Lord God, and appointed us to be here even this very day at this very moment, Lord God. We come and thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood that you gave for our sins. In Jesus' holy name. Oh, Lord God, thank you for the privilege and honor of being called Christians, Lord God. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are here with us, Lord God. That where two or more are gathered, you are there also, Lord God. Lord Jesus, sweep across us now, Lord God, with your Holy Spirit. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, Lord God Almighty. Come and move in our midst. In Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen and amen. Inside the house of God, praise God. What a privilege it is. We are privileged. We take that for granted so often that we're just going to go to church. We're just going to go to church, see what happens there, you know, and then we'll go home and we'll eat and we'll do this and we'll do all this other stuff. No, we are privileged by God Almighty to come into His presence, to come into His house, that He welcomes us into His home. Oh, man. What an awesome privilege and honor it is that He came and said, yeah, I want you guys to come into my house. And we need to come, just as David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. There's safety there in the sanctuary where it's safe. There's a sanctuary here. There's a sanctuary, praise God. And we get to come into the sanctuary of God. He's safe and sound from all the insanity that's out there. Anyone got anything crazy going on in their life? I know, Cindy, you don't have anything going on, do you?
Okay.
Just saying. Just a few of us might have one or two little items going on in our lives, right? That's okay. Praise God. Because He has overcome the world. In this world, we'll have tribulation, that's it. But praise God. Of good cheer, He has overcome the world, and we can come in here for that fellowship, to where we fellowship with one another and we hold each other up and carry each other's burdens. And we need that time of healing together. We need that time of healing together. We need that time where we can come and lean on one another and hold one another and say, yes, our Jesus is still on the throne. He hasn't lost track of one iota of what's going on in our lives. He knows exactly what's happening all around us. But He chose us from everything else, from everyone else. He chose us. And we're coming today to talk about growing up. Yes, I know. I was about to do that. I just wanted to say, though, we're coming to talk about growing up. Growing up in the Lord. So growing up in Him and maturing. And as we bring these young men here, they're going to stay here. Okay. Well, that's good. That's a good thing. I like that. I think that sometimes we need to keep the little ones in with us because it's so important. I know they get great stuff back there, but sometimes they need to know what the Lord God is doing in the church as well. And what we're going to talk about today is a very important thing, a very important part of our lives as believers. You know, I want to read a quick little thing from you out of the paper, out of the newspaper. I need my spectacles on to do so. We've had some amazing things happen in the world here recently. And here is a quote from the Alabama Supreme Court Chief Justice Ray Moore. It was out of the paper on Monday. And it says that Christians will be persecuted after the ruling on this gay marriage thing. Christians will be persecuted. And this is what he has. This is, has to say. This is the Supreme Court Chief Justice of Alabama. And this is what he has to say. Welcome to the new world. It's just changed for you Christians. You're going to be persecuted according to the U.S. Supreme Court dissents. We are going to be persecuted because we're going to stand up for the Word of God. Amen. Unless we're one of those that fold up under the pressure and go along with the flow. I was reading this morning to where a dead fish can float downstream. A dead fish can float downstream, but it takes a live fish to swim against the current.
Amen.
And go up to where the Lord God has got in store for us. Amen. I got that out of a Bible that a brother of mine gave me, called the Evidence Bible. It's awesome. Good stuff in there. Yes.
The Episcopal Church has officially endorsed the gay.
Yeah.
Gay marriage. They've already endorsed
homosexuals as
ministers.
Homosexuals. Yeah.
Who's that?
Yeah.
Light is going to light and darkness to darkness.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, exactly. And it is so important that we have this time of fellowship. It is so important that we continue in the Word of God and in His wisdom and in His ways. His ways are not our ways, praise God. His ways are higher than our ways.
Yes.
And He hasn't changed His Word at all. He goes on to say, is there such a thing as morality anymore? No, there isn't in the world. They have just gone over the deep end. And they're saying, whatever you want to do, we don't care. Just go out and do whatever you want.
Mm-hmm.
Praise God. Sodomy for centuries was declared to be against the laws of nature and nature's God. And now, if you say that in public, as I guess I am, and me too, I am violating somebody's civil rights. Have we elevated morality to immorality? Do we call good bad? What are we Christians to do? Praise God. We are going to stand with the Word of God. We will not compromise the Word of God. We cannot. Because we knew this day was coming. We knew this day was coming because it was forecast 2,000 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
We've got the written proof to show it.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are watching it happen before our eyes. We've been seeing it coming for the last 30, 40 years for certain. Isn't that incredible that we've seen it coming, but now as it's actually starting to really play out before us, it can get to be shocking. It can get to be something like, oh my goodness, really? You know, they can't be embracing one of the most unclean acts you can possibly have, but they're endorsing it and calling you a horrible person if you come against it. If you're saying no, just like he just got through saying, for centuries it's always been a horrible thing. And now they're saying, it's okay, it's good, let's let everybody do whatever they want to do. We have to make sure that we are growing up and swimming against the tide that is out there because it's too easy to get swept downstream. Praise God. If you've got your Bibles, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. We've been talking about and we've been witnessing the move of the Holy Spirit in the church. It has been a lot of fun to watch what God Almighty has been doing here lately in the church. In this church, praise God. It's been good. It's been fun. It's an awesome thing to come into the presence of the God Most High. But we come today in Ephesians chapter 4, and we're going to start in verse 11. So I'm going to continue with a little bit of what we had talked about before but this is a little bit different twist to it as to where we are right now. Ephesians 4:11 says, "And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers." For what? Why did he give all that? For the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. So many times we come into church and want to see what the pastor's got for us. "Okay, preacher, what you got for me today? Come and show me what you got today." No, this is for the equipping of the saints to go out and do the work of the ministry. Like we've talked about for the last several weeks, it isn't up to one person. That's a mighty imbalanced body, wouldn't it be?
Yes.
If it was just one arm or one leg or something, that'd be an odd-looking thing. Mm-hmm. I remember the cartoon back, what was it, where they had the little guy with one great big eye. What was the name? Monsters, Inc., right? Mm-hmm. Monsters, Inc. Old Mikey, wasn't it? Mikey. Isn't that great? Perfect. That's a one big eye. Right? That's okay, though. But, you know, we need everybody doing what they're doing. And that's what we've been talking about lately, is it's amazing to see how God's church, this body of believers, is doing what God has called them to do. That is so awesome that you're looking out for one another. You're not coming and just looking to one person to do everything, but you're coming together and working together and doing the work of the ministry.
Amen.
That's what it's called to be. And you get to be a part of it. You can choose not to be. Bad decision, but you can choose not to be. But praise God, the vast majority of this church is working together.
Amen.
Oh man, that is so awesome. Because I was just listening again on the radio the other day where they were saying 80% of the work in the church is done by 20% of the people. And I would even have an issue with that, saying that it's a lot more like 95% of the work is done by 5% of the people, at best.
Yes.
In most churches, every church I've ever been in. Matter of fact, every church I've ever been in. This one is different, though, praise God. Because we've matured, we've come to the point to where we are realizing, you are realizing, I have a ministry, and God Almighty has ordained me to do that ministry. And I can go and visit people in hospitals as well. I can go and lift up my sister when she needs to be lifted up. I can go over and mow someone's yard if they don't have the ability to do it themselves. I can go over and help in the food pantry when it's needed. Praise God. We're working together as one, as a body. It's not all about one person. If it's all about one person, it's got to be Jesus that's got to be about, right?
Amen.
Amen. It's not all about me. I have a job to do. And I am doing the job as best I can with all the craziness that's going on around me. But praise God, I'm going to do a better job yet, because I've been seeking God's face and saying, "Lord God, deliver me to where I can get focused again." I apologize that I have not been able to be as focused as I needed to be. But praise God, I am moving on. I will not allow the enemy to deter me from the work that God Almighty has called me to do. I will fulfill it. I will fulfill it. And if you have that same attitude,
yes,
to where it's not all about you, brother, go ahead and do whatever you got to do. No. But everyone has the attitude, I want to say, I've got a job to do in this church. And if I'm not there, they're missing an eye. They're missing their pinky finger. You ever try and grab something without a pinky finger? It's not easy to do. We need you. Like Brother Bill always says, maybe you're the armpit, but hey, we need an armpit, right? Someone's got to do the sweating. We've got some armpits because a lot of us sweat a lot around here, doing a lot of physical work. That's okay. But praise God, we need that. But again, it says some to be apostles, ones that go out from here that we send out together, and we really wanted to lay our hands on our brother. Brother Bill and I did this morning, before Doug left, to send him out. We're sending him out from this church, praise God. We laid hands on him. We say he's still going to be a member of this church. He might be 1,000 miles away, but that's okay. And I don't know if we'll see him again, or rarely anyway. About to come and steal his wife away again. That's just so selfish of him. Wants her all to himself, you know. But that's okay. And their child, whatever, I keep saying, one minute I'll call him him, and the next minute I'll call her her. I don't know what it is. But praise God. But we're going to keep her around for a while.
Amen.
And love on her.
Yes.
And encourage her.
Yes, Lord.
Praise God. At least he won't be around the other side of the world, at least be on the same continent as she's on right now. Praise God. But we come together and build her up and hold her up and keep her busy.
Praise Lord.
Keep you busy? Okay, good. Good. We like keeping you busy. We need your help. We need you to be a part of this body, and you are a part of this body. And we covet your talents and everything that God has given you.
Yes.
And the same with everyone else here. We need you to be working and doing what you're called to do. And 90% of you are doing that. That's so awesome. That is so great. But some to be apostles, some prophets, and we've got people that God uses with the gift of prophecy in this congregation. Some evangelists. You know, when we say evangelists, well, that's the people that's got this certain gift that go off and evangelize and witness to the world, right? Well, it's not necessarily a gift. It is, you know what another interpretation of the word evangelist is? Another description of it in the Bible is called love. It's called love. They love people enough that they care enough to go out and say, hey, brother, I know where you're headed, and I found a better way. His name is Jesus Christ. He is the one that redeems us from this world and brings us our ticket to heaven. He punched the ticket already. But they have enough love in their hearts to reach out and say, hey, I love you. You know, there's a couple of guys, Penn and Teller, the comedians, or if you can call them that, but they're Penn and Teller. About a year ago or more, I guess, I saw a thing on Facebook. I think someone put it out, and they're comedians. One's a big guy, and one's a little guy that doesn't say anything, and I don't remember which one's which. But the big guy went on YouTube and put this on there about a year or so ago, and he said that, you know, after their gigs, after they're done with their show, a lot of people will come up and say, hey, brother, that was really great, you know, wonderful, glad to hear that, really fun, or whatever, you know. And he sits and is kind enough to sit and listen. But this one guy came up and started by saying, I really admire your ability to speak clearly and your mastery of speech and everything like that. And he said, I could tell that this guy wasn't just blowing smoke at me, that he really meant what he was saying, that he really appreciated the way I can speak so well and everything, because it is a gift. It's a talent that is given, one that I would love to have a little bit better gifting in, Lord, if you're hearing. But that's okay. But the guy went on to share the gospel with him. And he is a devout atheist. He knows that there is no God. But he said this. He said, I don't mind listening to someone share the gospel with me, because how much would you have to hate me if you saw me what you think is going to hell and you didn't warn me? And this is from a devout atheist saying, how much would you have to hate me if you didn't at least warn me of what you think is right? He doesn't believe it. He says, oh, I know there's still no God or anything like that. But he was willing to sit and listen. But he, at the end of it, the man impressed him so much with his love for him and caring about him, that he made this ditty and put it on YouTube for all to see. I really appreciated that man, he said. That was a good man. He kept saying, that was a good man. That was a good man. He could see the love that came out of him. Instead of, you gonna burn in hell. You know, I still haven't seen that work on much of anyone. I just don't see that in the Word of God. I don't see where Jesus did that when he was trying to reach the lost. He lambasted the so-called religious leaders and called them about every kind of snake in the grass he could come up with. But when he's reaching out to someone, he reaches them in love. An evangelist is another word for love. If you love people enough, you don't have to be an evangelist, so to speak, but if you have enough love for someone to say, hey, man, what's going on in your life? I want to help. I want to be a part of it. And it doesn't matter whether they're a believer or not, especially your brothers and sisters, yes. But when you reach out to someone at work, even the one that's always the one that grates you, anyone ever run into that, or is it just me? Run into people that kind of grate you from time to time? Yeah. Well, praise God, you can go over and start to get to know them a little bit, you know? Kind of wrap your arms around them and say, hey, man, how are you doing today? Yeah, I know, but you know, this is what's going on in my life, and what about what's going on in your life? And before you know it, they'll start opening up, and you'll realize there's an actual human being under there, underneath all that hard crust. Because we get hardened. A lot of people, I always say, how miserable must they be if they're that nasty to everybody? And truly, if you can understand that person must be just walking around in absolute misery all the time, and I can reach in there and show them the love of God, because they're hurting inside. A lot of them don't even realize how much they're hurting. A lot of them don't realize how much they're empty until you start talking with them and sharing the love of Jesus with them and sharing the hope where there is no hope.
Yes.
There is no hope here. There is no light. It is darkness out there, and it's getting darker by the day. But we love them enough to say, what can I do for you? Is there anything I can help you with? For the one that really grates on you? Yeah, that's okay. But to some, the evangelists and some pastors and teachers, he's given us jobs. He's given us different things to do. But it is all for the equipping of you to do the work of the ministry.
Yes.
That's the whole point. It's not just, like I've said before, it's not a spectator sport. It's a job for you to do. This is something that God Almighty is putting for you. Did I just misread that or something? Well, let me see. For the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry. Oh, I got it right. I got it right. You actually have a job to do from God. Oh, it's not just the pastor that's supposed to do everything? No. You are called to come and say, what are you got to show me how I can be equipped today? So I can go out and do the work of the ministry. That's what I love about this, that so many people are here doing that. For the edifying of the body. For the edifying of the body. That again, you know, when Cindy started the food pantry, her first rule was, there's no arguing. There's no bitterness. There's no strife. We won't put up with that. We cannot have bitterness and division and strife in the church. We can't have it. It's a killer. And when it happens, we have to rise up immediately, even when something else is going on and everything else is happening in our lives, we need to go and immediately deal with it. Say, wait a minute, no, we're not about that. What's going on in your life to cause you to be doing that? How can we help you to overcome this sin? Overcome this sin, because bitterness and division and strife is sin. Amen? Unless I've misread it. And I hadn't misread it, have I? No, I like that. You guys got this, I'm telling you. But it is a killer. It will tear up a church quicker than anything else. So we keep a close eye on it to where we don't allow it to grow. Will the enemy come in and try and sneak his way in? Absolutely. But it is part of my job and the elders and everyone else's job here as well to, when you hear something, go, wait a minute, that doesn't sound right. Let me go get with Pastor Mike or whoever else, any one of the elders or deacons or whatever, and say, wait a minute, we need to come together with this, and we've got an issue that we need to deal with. So we come and we deal with it because it is for the edifying of the body, to build each other up, not to tear each other down. Till we all come to the unity of the faith. Unity. Coming together in unity. And again, that's what I love about this particular church. We have come together in that unity. We can send out a message saying, oh, Sister So-and-so's in the hospital, or or whatever's going on, and boy, everybody is, I get about a 50 different texts back saying, oh my goodness, okay, we're praying. All at once. And what room are they in? Let me go there. I'll be right there. Everything else, right? Praise God. We are coming together in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God. We need to know who He is and what He has done for us. We need to be able to put His life into practice in our own life. We are Christ ones, Christians. We're supposed to be imitating Him. We're supposed to have, whenever someone looks at us, they should know that we're Christian. They should know that we're following God Almighty and that they can come. But we're growing up in the knowledge, in the stature. I like that. Let me back up a little bit. Yeah, the knowledge of the Son of God to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Full, standing up straight in Him.
Yes.
Not just I got a little bit here and now, here and again, I might act like I'm a believer on Sunday mornings. Or Wednesday nights, I'll come in and put on my happy face, but as soon as I go out, I'm going to be yelling, I'm going to get on board. No, we're standing up straight and strong and presenting ourselves as believers. And the people can see it. Praise God. That we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried away with every wind of doctrine. So many people, when something like this happened that we're reading about in the papers, that is in the papers today, where sin is running rampant and is becoming the right thing instead of the wrong thing to do, that we stand instead of going, oh my goodness, everything, oh boy, this is really getting bad out there, and saying, well, it's not so bad. I guess, you know, they can do whatever they want to do. Doesn't bother me and all that sort of stuff, right? No. To where we stand up, that we're no longer tossed to and fro and carried away with every wind of doctrine. So many times we have Christians that are, I call them spiritual butterflies, that just flit here and there. Oh, did you hear what's going on at the church over here? Well, let's go over there, and oh my goodness, it's wonderful. Oh, wait a minute, they're doing something great over at this other church. Let me go see this. It's like, wait a minute, no. You're not part of the body of Christ at that point. You are a spiritual butterfly. You can't land in one place and become attached to that body and work together in the unifying of the body of Christ. We have to be working together. You are needed in a body. And if you're here, you're needed in this body. Praise God. We get to be a part of the body. We can separate ourselves with wrong decisions, but we can do that. But we should no longer be children. That is immaturity. That is spiritual immaturity, to flit here and there, back and forth. But that we should, but by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. So many different churches do all sorts of crazy things to get people to come in. Now, there's nothing wrong with doing things to try and reach the community. That's what we should be doing, is out there trying to reach the community. But sometimes they put on this show, right? To show and do all these things to get people to come in, and we're going to entertain them, we're going to do this and that and everything else, when the Spirit of God hasn't said to do it. Now, if God tells us to do a certain thing, we'll do a certain thing, praise God. But we're not out there advertising we're the fun place to be here or anything like that. We're coming here to worship God Almighty. If you want to be a part of it, come on in. Praise God, because He is here and we get to enjoy Him. But the enemy is the cunning and crafty and deceitful in his plotting to keep you away from this church. But speaking the truth in love may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, which is Christ. Grow up. That we grow up. No longer act like kids, to where I want to do my own thing. I don't care. I'm going to do whatever I want to do. And if God comes around, I'll go to the church every once in a blue moon. But know that we're growing up, that we're speaking the truth in love. You know, we had a guy six, 8 months ago or more that came by to one of our prayer meetings. that spoke amazing truth about the Muslims and what's going on with all those guys, and about a lot of other different things that's happening in our country and in the world today, and exposing so many different things. It was amazing to sit and listen to this guy. But he didn't do it in love. He spoke the truth, but he didn't do it in love. It was all, you stupid Americans, you stupid people for doing this, you stupid people for doing that, and allowing this. How dare you sit there and it's like, wow, man, I hear what you're saying, but can we get a little bit of love in the middle of that too, right? We can speak the truth, but again, just not the you're going to burn in hell kind of stuff, right? We come and say, oh, Lord, brother, I want to wrap my arms around you. What can I do to help you? Not you, you sinful thing, you. What are you doing coming in here calling yourself a believer, right? No, but we speak the truth, but we speak it in love. It has to have that love, or else it's nothing. It's nothing. It will not be received if it's not in the love that Jesus gives us. But we grow up. We grow up. We mature. Okay, I'm going to put away the childish things, and I'm going to grow up. I'm going to move on into Him who is the head, into Christ. I'm going to mimic Him. Whatever you want me to do, I'm going to get off the throne of my life. We get down our own throne so often. I'm my own Lord. I'll do whatever I want to do. And Lord, if I got any time, I'll give you some too. No, no, no. Either He's our Lord or He's not. If He's not our Lord, who is our Lord? And most of the time, it's us. I met the enemy and he is us. There's an old comic strip like that. Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Every joint supplies a certain part to hold it together. To hold it together. We need everyone here working together to hold the body together. Otherwise, without the sinews and everything holding the body together, that love intermingling amongst us and holding us together, everything just kind of flies apart, right? There's nothing to hold it together. You don't have a nail holding a house together. You just stick it up there. First little breeze comes along, you slam the door and the thing's going to fall down, right? We've got to have everything holding everything together. Every joint supplies the things that joins us and knits us together according to the effective working by which every part does its share. And again, we're talking about everyone doing their share, everyone doing their part, and it works together so beautifully. That's why he continually uses the body as an example, because the body has to work together. If you have one thing that's not working properly, it messes everything up. You can stub your toe, amen? Yeah, I'm looking at you. You stub your toe and break the tip of your toe, and it hurts everything, doesn't it? It messes everything up. You wouldn't know, right? Okay. But everyone working and doing their share causes the body, the growth of the body, for the edifying of itself in love. Everyone working together, we all grow up together. We come together and we walk together in peace and in love and in joy, coming before Him and worshiping Him. We were talking about, I think it was a Wednesday night or something, where we're talking about where they're saying that they came together to serve the Lord. And at the same time, they were serving each other, right? They were serving God in their service. They were serving the Lord, but at the same time, they were ministering to one another as a side effect of worshiping the Lord and ministering to Him. Because if you have that much love, if you're filled with Him, like Pat was saying this morning, we can't have our eyes on two different things at the same time. We can't have our eyes on Him and have our eyes on what's going on around us as well. Oh, but boy, that toe really hurts. You know? Or we can't have, oh my goodness, so-and-so's in the hospital or whatever's going on around us. We can't have our eyes in two different places. If we have our eyes here, He is our Lord and He is still working. And all these other things, He will give us that wisdom He will give us the knowledge of how to do things. He will put things in our mind we couldn't come up with ways to make these things work. Who was I just talking with the other day? Apologize, my brain's been scrambled, but I was talking to someone the other day where something wild happened in their life that solved a problem. It was like, how in the world? There's no way you could possibly dream up these ways to come up with to solve these problems. Was it you seen it? I thought so, yeah. It's like, how in the world could you ever come up with it? But we keep coming up with all these plans, and Lord, if you just do it this way and this way and this way, does it ever work? I don't think I've ever had him answer my plan. But we'll come up with great plans, right? But no. He comes up with plans we couldn't possibly. How do you come up with that, Lord? How do you make that work? I don't understand how you make it work, but somehow you pull something out of a hat and make it work, and it works perfectly. And an answer that you would not have come up with ever. That sometimes we think is a bad thing, that all of a sudden it turns into a good thing. That God has worked it around. All things work together for good for those who love the Lord. According to his purposes. It seemed like I read that somewhere before, right? Matter of fact, turn on with me to the book of Ephesians. I'm sorry, 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 4. If I could read my own writing, it'd be good. 1 Peter chapter 4. Starting in verse 7. That's in the New Testament, by the way. Anyone catch that? Okay. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7. Listen to this. But the end of all things is at hand. Wow. You think that's for us today? The end of all things is at hand. Right now, man, of all times. It was true when he wrote this. 2,000 years ago, but it is even much more true right now, and we have the evidence to read in the newspaper, right? You can't get away from it. That is why we need to be mature. We need to be focused right now, more than ever. The end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be serious and watchful in your prayers. Be serious. It's time to grow up. It's time to be serious and grow up. We can't just keep flitting around and doing whatever we think is good for ourselves, making ourselves our own God. But it's time to be serious and watchful, focused on what we're doing, focused in our prayers, and above all things, have fervent love for one another. What were we just talking about? Loving one another, right? Isn't that amazing how, is that the Word of God? It is the Word of God. Imagine that. Above all things, everything else, above everything else, have fervent love for one another. Fervent love for one another. That's why I want to go and look out for you. That's why you have the desire to go and be a part of each other's lives. We have to be serious about this and grow up and move on and have that fervent love for one another. For love will cover a multitude of sins. Oh, well, but sister so-and-so drives me crazy. Brother so-and-so drives me nuts. Hey, the love will cover up a multitude of sins, right? You overlook. Anyone married here? Okay. Is your spouse perfect?
Yeah, I am.
No. Is your spouse's spouse perfect? Here you are. You're the exception, though. We understand that. But let me ask you this question. Is your spouse's spouse perfect? Because I are my spouse's spouse. But when we love one another, love is a commitment. Yes. It's not just a gooey-ooey feeling. Oh, I'm just so in love. It's all sweet and all that. We should have that, yes. There should be that kind of love. But true love is a commitment to one another. And when they get stupid and do something like I do to Cindy all the time, right? She just goes, hey, it's okay. You did this and I really, oh, Lord God, thank you for pointing that out. And mean it. Thank you for showing me
the stupidity of what I just did. I didn't know it. If I would have known it, I wouldn't have done it to begin with, right? But if you can go in love to them and say, hey, that really hurt when you said that. It really hurt when you did that. Your response should be, oh man, thank you for showing me that so I can put a watch on myself not to do the same stupid thing over and over again. Amen? And that's your relationship with anyone, whether you're married or not married or whatever. This is your relationship to the world, to your brother and sister. And when you see, you get involved with your brother or sister's life and you see that they're not perfect, like you're not, we come and say, that's okay, brother and sister, I love you. That overwhelming love, what's he call it? That vehement love comes over and covers their sins. It's okay. I know you didn't mean to do it. I've got a sister that I am sure isn't going to watch this, so I'll say, she tends to say things that she doesn't realize what she's saying. She really does have, unfortunately, a bit of dementia, and she tends to splurt things out of her mouth without realizing at all what she's doing. She really has not lost a lot of control over her speech. And when before Cindy and I go over there, we automatically say, we know her, we know that she loves us, and we love her, and we're not going to sit there and nitpick over things that might come out of her mouth. So that's okay. That's our sister. We love her. She's a fantastic believer, fantastic prayer warrior. And we're not going to allow ourselves to get our little feelings hurt because you said something to me. Mm-hmm. How silly, you know? But we do it all the time.
Yeah.
We do it all the time. So-and-so said something to me and it just hurt my feelings. Well, do you know their heart? Well, if you believe that they're a true believer, you know their heart is love, and if they had any idea what they were doing, they wouldn't have done it. So you immediately forgive. And if you're prompted, you can go and say, hey, brother, remember when you said that? It really hurt, you know? I'd really appreciate it if you wouldn't. And if they're a true brother or sister, they'll go, oh, man, wow, I didn't even know I did that. I'm so sorry. Forgive me. And you keep an eye on me to where if you see me doing anything like that again, point it out to me so that I can stop. You know, I've told you guys so many times, if you see me doing something wrong, and this is serious from the heart, tell me. I can't afford to do something stupid. I can't afford to go out and hurt one of you guys of all people. I can't afford to allow myself the luxury of doing whatever I want to. Doesn't matter what they're doing. I'm just going to speak the truth. I've had someone just tell me recently, well, it's true what I said. I don't care if it's true. It's got to be in love. Speak the truth in love. Right? You got to speak it in love. So, praise God. Be hospitable to one another without grumbling. That's an interesting one, isn't it? Be hospitable to one another without grumbling. Oh, you mean I gotta go over there again, Lord? You know, and I don't want to cook them a meal. I don't want to do this or anything like that. That's grumbling, isn't it? Kind of sounds like grumbling to me. But be hospitable to one another without grumbling. If you're gonna go over and help your brother or sister do something or build them up or whatever, don't grumble about it. I knew a guy one time years and years ago, back in Colorado, that was called to the work of a deacon. But he would grumble about it. He would go over and he was a carpenter, and he would go over and help people and build a shed or repair something or something like that. But once he got there, he'd be grumbling the whole time. And I was like, brother, you're missing out on all your blessing. You're being a blessing to people, but with all your grumbling, you just lost all of your blessings that the Lord God wanted to give you. Do it with a glad heart, you know. You're called to do a certain job, go do it. Even if you're not called necessarily, you see your brother hurting, you want to go over and help, you know. Hey, I'll go mow your yard. Well, I don't have that ability right now, but that's okay. But I'll go over and do whatever it takes to be a part of your life and to watch over you. So, be hospitable to one another without grumbling. As each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Man, as each one has received a gift, minister it to one another, just like we've been talking about through the whole thing. As good stewards of the manifold grace of God, we have been given grace by God Almighty. Let's be good stewards of that. Let's be good stewards of it. In other words, taking it to heart and actually doing what God Almighty has called us to do. Doing and ministering to one another, putting other people's needs ahead of my own. My own wants and desires, I lay them aside so that the Lord God can be used and I can minister to my brother and my sister. Right? Isn't that awesome? I love that. If anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If anyone ministers, let him do it with the ability which God supplies, that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. In all things God may be glorified. That should always be our first thought, is that we want to glorify God. And that should be the first thing. And I just wanted to read this one verse, verse 12. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing had happened to you. Don't think it strange when all the fiery darts of the enemy comes blasting at you from every angle, as if something strange has happened to you. We, so many times, I don't understand. This can't possibly be God that's allowing this to happen in my life. Well, has God lost control of the universe? No. He's still got the universe in the palm of his hands. He's still got you in the palm of his hands. And in this world, you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I will overcome the world. He wants to prove to you and bring us through. Sometimes he will quench the fire. Sometimes he'll walk with us through the fire. Did he pull Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego out of the fire? He was in there with them. They had to go into that fire. Can you imagine what was going through their heads when they had to go into that fire? Or Daniel in the lion's den? Did he take him out of the lion's den? No. He had to go in there and have faith that God Almighty was going to save him. God's got this. That's the difference. Doesn't matter. I love it to where Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego told a good old Nebuchadnezzar, hey, doesn't matter. It's not even a thing to be debated whether God will save us or not. Our God is able to save us out of the fiery furnace. And even if he doesn't, it doesn't matter. We're still not going to bow down to your stupid idol and worship your idol instead of God Almighty. It's not debatable. What are we got nothing talking about here, man? We're going to follow God, and that's all there is to it. And if we go into the fiery furnace, we go into the fiery furnace. Even though I pity, he slay me, I will still serve him. Praise God. That's where we need to be. And that's where so many of you have gotten to the point. Praise God. And that's what's great. And the rest of us, we want to encourage the ones that are still in the midst of some of these things, that are learning these lessons that we may have already learned. And that's when we have that fellowship. Hey, I've been through something like you're going through, right? I've been through it, and this is what helped me. The Word of God says this, and I applied it to my life. I took it as if it actually meant something and watched it work in my life. And we can build each other up. We can come and say, hey, God hasn't lost control of your life at all unless you've taken it away from him. And if you have, don't do that. Lay it back down. Make him still the Lord God. And he will bring us through, no matter what fiery furnace we're in or what lion's den we're in the middle of, he can be there with you. And you learn, oh man, it's so awesome to see that God made us come through that. That God can bring us through even in the midst of the craziest things that we can imagine. Praise God. Thank you for being a part of this body. I know we've got a lot of people out right now. That's okay. It's a holiday weekend. We got some people who are in the hospital and things like that. That's okay. That's the way it is. But thank you for being a part of this body. We appreciate it very, very much. And it is so encouraging to see the way this body has matured and come together in unity and peace and watching out for one another in the love that you show for one another. That, again, has always been the thing here with Lighthouse. The love of God Almighty being shown here. Like Brother Bill said many, many years ago, the guys across the street would say, you send those crazy people over to those guys across the street, they'll take anyone. Yep, you're right. We'll take anyone. It doesn't matter. And the one thing that people always say, it says when they come to visit here for the first time, they say it was the love that drew us in. It was the love of God being manifest and shown. And that's what Jesus said. You'll know them by their love for one another. Praise God. And you are to be commended for coming and saying, yes, I'll be a part of that. Because the love overcomes a multitude of sins, right? Amen. Praise God. This stuff actually works. Is that what you're telling me?
Yes.
Ooh, man. This stuff actually works. Yes. Let's go before the Lord God Almighty. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord God Almighty, that we can come into your presence, Lord Jesus, that you welcome us, that you paid the price, because you wanted us in your presence so much, that you wanted fellowship with us. Thank you for choosing us to be a part of this work here, Lord God, at Lighthouse. Oh, Lord Jesus, thank you for knitting us together. Just as a body is held together by every little sinew, Lord God, everyone has a part of holding this thing together, Lord God. And it's your love that intertwines among us, Lord Jesus, that holds us together and binds us together, Lord Jesus. Come and move in our hearts, move in our midst. Thank you for your word today, Lord God. And as we go out into the world, let us truly put your word into effect, Lord God, to where we grow up and put aside the childish things and get serious about this, Lord God, because this world is getting very serious about running from you and cursing you and spitting in your face. But Lord Jesus, let us wake up and be serious about our walk with you, Lord God. And you will reward us greatly, for our reward in heaven is great. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for every soul that's in this place today, Lord God. Let them know that they are much loved by me and by you and by one another. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the privilege of serving you. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen.